Alright, so they recently played Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid in theaters.
Yes.
Which we attended instead of the Critics' Choice Awards.
Right.
Which I don't know about you, but I don't regret.
Nope.
So, so we were sitting there and we were waiting for the movie to start. And I just kind of... Because it gets very annoying when every time a movie comes up that we haven't done for this yet, you immediately say, what can we do with it? Just think of something we can do with it and we'll do this. So,
yeah.
I kind of got ahead of you, and I didn't realize you hadn't seen this, so I thought you were already ahead in there, so I just thought I'd beat you to it. So, they're playing the stuff, and the movie's getting ready to start, and I just kind of turn to you in jest and say, I suppose you're going to want me to do this with the Assassination of Jesse James or something. And then, and then it turned out that we didn't really have a plan for this week. So I was like, well, fuck. Now that I've really, really got Butch Cassidy right here in my head still, why not? So, they're obviously, we're dealing with two totally different tones here as far as how we follow these outlaws and what their story is, but I still think we're kind of in the close enough vicinity that this works well. So I think we're going to start with, go ahead and start with Butch Cassidy since it's still fresh in my head. Where it's, it really pulls us in, immediately with the, opening credits sequence, which is the film reel, where it's just, we kind of get a really quick backstory on them, but the great thing I always loved about this scene is it's, the only sound while we're watching this film reel and see the credits go by are, the score and the sound of, like, the film turning. And that's all we really have. And it just plays out this nice backstory for us in a very old-fashioned way. Which kind of continues on with the, our whole opening scene with, Butch in the bank and then, Sundance during the card game. Has kind of, they kind of do a Wizard of Oz type thing, where it kind of keeps kind of the appearance of that film footage we saw during the opening credits, and it kind of has this brown tint to it throughout the opening. And then once that scene plays out and their characters are established, like really in the foreground now, and not just kind of a quick backstory way, the scene dissolves and we go into them riding out into the really big landscape. And as we watch them ride out in this one shot, that brown tint slowly turns to color, which is a thing I've always really loved. I always also kind of wondered, I don't know if they would have had the technology in 69 to do this or anything like that, but it would have been, I always wondered what it would have been like if they kind of played with the aspect ratio, though. Where it was the, it kind of stayed the aspect ratio of the news footage for that whole opening scene, and then not only did it go into color, but it got bigger and wider as they went into the landscapes. But like I said, I don't know if 69 technology could do that, but it's just a thought. So we, it's very, what makes these characters so intriguing, the two of them mainly, is, it's interesting to watch how they get into the situations they do, because they're always, they're clearly extremely clever, and they clearly got the notorious reputation they have for a reason. And as the movie goes, we see that they always somehow manage to kind of stay ahead of the game, and always know what the next move is going to be and act on it. But regardless of this, they still kind of come off very bumbling in a way. Despite the fact that they're so clever and can outwit anything that's kind of in their path. And also the fact that it's Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid with his name first. It's Butch Cassidy and the Hole in the Wall gang with his name plus the rest of them as a collective. So it's kind of established through that alone that Butch is kind of our leader. But there's kind of like, they're kind of on an equal stance, the two of them, despite the fact that you think of the name the Sundance Kid and you think that, you know, not only is Butch kind of considered their leader, but he also has seniority to the point that Kid is in Sundance's name. But throughout the movie, they're really kind of, one's not really the leader of the other, and there's kind of the whole, like, there's moments where you kind of, it's kind of established that Butch is the leader. He makes that a very abundant point when he's getting into the fight with the guns or knives fight. But then there are those moments where they're being chased, and Butch will turn to Sundance and say, like, you know, how long do you think they're going to chase us? And do you think they figured this out, or they figured that out? As if it's Sundance who's leading him sometimes. So I really liked the way that that's kind of, there's really no one or the other here. They're very much kind of on, one's not really the sidekick of the other, despite the fact that that's generally how it's looked at by somebody who either hasn't seen the movie or hasn't seen it for a very long time. And the whole idea of, as I was saying, we're kind of somewhere in a line between extremely clever and bumbling. And you get that idea because they're so clever that they're actually kind of extremely cocky about it. There are a number of examples of this, but the one obviously that really stands out is after they've robbed the train the first time, there's the scene where they're trying to form the mob to go after them. And they're talking about how they're probably just long out of town now, and that's why we have to get moving now and go out there and find them. And they are across the street watching from the balcony of the brothel across the street. And it gets to the point to where you start to wonder if maybe they're a little too cocky. And then, of course, there's the scene of foreshadowing when they go to the sheriff's house, and he says, he basically warns them that you're never going to get out of this, and when you die, it's going to be bloody. And, of course, we know that that is obviously proven true. And while we're on the subject, it's also worth noting, in a bit of irony, that the sheriff in this movie, in the same year, played Tom Chaney in the original True Grit. Very opposite sides of the law and kind of the same genre in the same year. I thought that was cool. Yeah, but then another thing that really, really makes their dynamic work, apart from the fact we could just talk about Newman and Redford all day.
Yeah.
Because obviously George Roy Hill is the director, and it stars the two of them, and this is they would all migrate 4 years later to The Sting and go from being nominated to Best Picture and Best Director to winning both of those. We also have this, I almost even hesitate to call it a love story. The scenes with Catherine Ross, who is, he obviously by this point you would know her mainly from The Graduate 2 years prior to this. But she is Sundance's girlfriend, and we learn this through a fake-out scene where we think that Sundance has kind of bitterly left Butch to the women at the brothel. And when he goes to her house, it's kind of made up to be like, basically made up to be like he's going to rape her at gunpoint.
Yeah.
But it turns out it's just some weird roleplay thing they do. And we figure out, we establish that they are a couple. But then the very next scene is the very famous scene where Butch shows up on his bike. And the raindrops he's falling on my head scene happens. And what I really love that this movie does is, obviously in this moment, immediately your brain jumps to one thing, and that's that the movie is starting a love triangle, to the point to where she clearly has more chemistry with Butch than she does with Sundance, but Sundance is the one that she's with. And then we actually have that moment where she's talking to him on their way back, and it's clear there's a connection there, and it gets to the point to where she actually says, you know, Butch, if I had met you first, I wonder if it'd be different. And it kind of gives you that love triangle vibe. And then, of course, they can joke about it when Sundance comes out and says, he just says, I'm stealing your girl. And he says, fine, keep her, and walks away. she is Sundance's girl, and the idea of her and Butch being a thing, whether at one point or any time in the future, is never mentioned again. They just, it's kind of there, but it can't be, so we just never come back to it. And I thought that was kind of, because that could have totally been the direction we went if we had a lazy screenwriter. But as soon as that's established, it's just not a thing anymore. It's there in between them, but we just never talk about it again. And obviously we know her and Sundance eventually go on to get married, so... And then there is, and that's, that scene, by the way, obviously this won 4 different Oscars, with, cinematography, song, score, and original screenplay, all of which are deserved in one way or another. Like I was saying, the cinematography looked unreal on that theater screen. Yeah, I was so glad we got to see it that way. Extremely, extremely glad we got to see it that way. And then it's one of those scripts where it's, the dialogue is so memorable, and just the whole structure of it is really well put together, in itself, but the dialogue specifically, this is one of those movies where the lines are so memorable that you can watch this movie a number of times, and then not watch it for a very long stretch of time, and then when you watch it again after years of not watching it, you can still remember every line as they come out. So it's always nice to find a movie like that. I always associate Reservoir Dogs with that too. Like, I go very long periods of time without watching Reservoir Dogs, but I still know every single line right before it comes whenever I am watching it. I'd say this falls into that category. And then, yeah, going back to the song, obviously it's kind of, because the song is used in a very, very happy way, showing the two of them doing their thing. But the thing about it is, pretty much every other movie that song is used in is for comedic purposes. So it's very interesting to kind of, when you see it in this movie and you see it within the context, because it's kind of, after you see it in all those comedic scenes, you generally see it as just a silly song. Like, just the between kind of the chorus and the movie, the other movies you've seen it in and the context you've seen it used in, it just all seems kind of silly. I'm looking at you, Spider-Man 2. Mm-hmm. And Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
Yeah.
But there, it's a bit of a serious connotation in Clerks 2, but there's still a comedic value to it, I think, in a way. But when you see it within the context of this movie, you can totally see it as an Oscar-winning song. And it's really important to see it specifically in that context, because it's just a really perfect moment in the movie with that scene. And then, of course, obviously, this movie eventually turns into a chase movie after the second time they rob the train, their second run-in with Woodcock. And then our unseen forces come in on a different train, and basically the entire next half of the movie is just a chase.
Yeah.
And it's very, it gets really, really tense also. Like the moment, I really, really love the scene when they are in, they're back at the brothel with the Cloris Leachman scene. And he hires Sweetface to go out and keep watch and say, oh, they went that way. And there's something very, very, like, I don't know if voyeuristic's the right term, but you basically kind of feel like you're there with them hiding also in that scene where we watch out the window as Sweetface kind of guides them off somewhere else, and then they kind of part ways and things are going to settle down, and then you hear the horse hooves coming back, and then that just kind of gets me every time. and then, of course, immediately Sweetface rats them out. that's a segment of the movie I really, really love. Because on top of that, and even though that chase scene can get, those chase scenes can get really, really tense, despite the fact that they're mainly from a distance, they're still really, really intense, no matter how far away we are from them, because there's always that sense that they're coming. But despite all this intensity, there's still those breaks for humor. One, obviously, that immediately comes to mind is when they're cornered on the cliff. And Sundance is already ready to go down in a blaze of glory. Halfway through the movie. Until Butch decides that they need to jump. And we learn, in this very tense moment, they could already be leading to their deaths. Sundance confesses that he can't swim. And Butch's response is to bust out laughing. And then the whole, the fall will kill you anyway. Let's just do it. So they're prepared to die either way, regardless. But it's a comedic moment. I heard you laughing hard when we hear Sundance screaming, "Oh shit," all the way down.
It was funny.
So there's that stuff. And then there's the idea, this is another clever use of dialogue on top of how we see the chase progress throughout the movie, which is the line, "Who are those guys?" is said like three different times, and each time it has a different meaning. Because we see them, and we know that they're cops of some sort, so they're running away from them, and then they just kind of get curious, and they're like, you know, "Who are those guys?" And then we realize how good those guys are at tracking and doing what they do. And then I think they say again, "Who are those guys?" But this time it's kind of more of an admiration thing. But when they just cannot get away from them and those guys follow them like the plague, "Who are those guys?" turns into exasperation. Like, who the fuck are they? And the great thing about that is we never really know.
Yeah.
Like we do learn it's who they thought it was with being Lord Voldemort and LaFours, but we never see their faces, and there's never really a time where we're up close and personal to them. The absolute closest we get is seeing a somewhat close up of the back of LaFours' head. That's as close as we get to seeing anything of the people that have been tracking them this whole time. And I always thought that was a really great effect. And it's obviously worth noting, there's a lot of really memorable side characters. One, in the second half of the movie, we're introduced to Strother Martin, who was brought over from 2 years earlier with Cool Hand Luke, with Paul Newman, as the dude that hires them and has a bunch of, funny lines. And then, one guy I always like, we don't see much of is News, when it's, when he's trying to tell the guy before he fights him that, I can't remember that guy's name for the life of me, the guy that wants to fight him at the beginning. But he's having News read the newspaper article about who they are. And his point is they are Butch Cassidy and the Hole in the Wall gang, as in Butch Cassidy is their leader. But News wants to read the whole thing until he gets to his own name, because he just likes it so much. Like I said, there's the returning character of Woodcock, who is absolutely hell-bent on protecting the money, even though he's just going to get blown up every time. To the point that they actually admire him, and they don't want to hurt him or anything. He just kind of gets himself in that situation.
Those are really funny scenes.
Yeah. And then, like, the moment where he's still kind of standing his ground, except he knows the dynamite's coming, so he stands behind the wall and keeps going with his speech. And then when he kind of amps up the safe a little bit and they end up blowing up the whole train car to get into it. Which ultimately gets them caught.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, that stuff is great. I do have to say, I don't think the movie is as strong as it once was once they're in Bolivia.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's near as strong as that first half is with the chase and all the different characters. But it still stands on its own. Like there's, you know, the scenes with him having to learn the language and getting the stuff mixed up, and there's plenty of stuff in it. There's the nice kind of, it's almost like an intermission of sorts, but it also kind of keeps us progressing where it shows, everything that happened in between to them getting to Bolivia through a slideshow of these pictures that actually look like they're from the 1800s or even before that, and just have them. Kind of. So, but yeah, regardless of that, it's still definitely, you can never not watch this movie and not watch the whole thing. It all fits together in nice one big piece. And of course, the ending is like one of the most famous endings of all time. They reference it in Beverly Hills Cop, which we just talked about.
Yep.
So yeah, regardless of, I don't think the second half is quite as strong as the first half. this still, with the performances and how just everything goes, and there's still those moments, plenty of moments of tension to go around. This pretty much just has everything that makes a classic a classic. So, yeah. You want to say anything real quick about your recent new experience with it?
It's weird because Western was never the genre that I would go to. The only John Wayne I had ever watched before this was The Quiet Man. It was during, like, a college class. And other than that...
It wasn't even really a Western, really.
Yeah, I know. No, the only, like, John Wayne I've ever watched would be that. So I've never really watched a Western before. And the Coen brothers did True Grit, and that would be, like, the first, like, real Western I ever watched. Well, yeah. Yeah, Yuma and True Grit would probably be the only ones. And then we started watching the movies, like, the big theatrical release movies, like The Searchers and now Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
The Searchers was really awesome.
The Searchers was incredible. I was like, am I missing out on this genre? I mean, maybe I need to go back and watch this stuff because I kind of have this thing about falling asleep during movies. But if I'm really into a movie, I'm going to stay wide awake. Because
Jesse James shows this too. And obviously Tarantino has been trying to show us. Mm-hmm. The Western is really one of the main genres that really like to show the scope of things.
Oh, yeah.
Like how huge The Searchers looked and how huge Butch Cassidy looks and The Hateful Eight most recently, obviously.
It looks magnificent.
And Jesse James is, of course, shot by Roger Deakins.
Yes.
And when Jesse James starts, it's basically this... We're kind of getting this storybook quality to it because it has one of those very old-fashioned narrators.
Mm-hmm.
And we just have all the imagery there. If there is one fault in Jesse James's cinematography, it is the fact that Deakins couldn't resist one thing. And that is, if you're going to have this massive, visually incredible movie, for one reason or another, you cannot go without that one shot of the hand going through the field of wheat. I think that's in every single goddamn movie with great cinematography.
Yeah.
It's in this one, too. But it's only there for a second, and then we have another 2.5 hours of just really incredibly well-shot stuff. And he was double nominated this year because he shot this the same year he shot No Country for Old Men.
Hmm.
So he was on fucking fire that year. And that's also kind of goes in with There Will Be Blood is definitely a worthy winner. But when you have those two Deakins movies out, that's when I really think about, yeah, dude definitely should have won by now. he did True Grit as well. Yeah. Another one that I kind of, as much as I love Inception, I feel like he probably should have won for that too.
That's why Ashley says Roger Deakins never wins.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's one of those things where, yeah, he gets nominated a lot, but typically you think, you know, it's just cause it's a strong competition. But having this in the country out in the same year, it's tough, but the fact that There Will Be Blood's a movie that won, but still, it's a tough call. So this is obviously from Andrew Dominik, who, this was the movie in between, he reunited with Pitt and gave us Killing Them Softly, and then prior to this he gave us Chopper with Eric Bana. So really... You totally get a vibe that Chopper and Killing Them Softly are by the same guy. This is something totally different from him. And this is just, like, on this really, really wide scale. Like, not just the length, but just in appearance itself. It just feels like an epic in every way. And obviously the main story is... Obviously, you know, Brad Pitt has our top credit. And Casey Affleck's Oscar nomination was in supporting... And Robert Ford's name is the smaller name here. But it's really him that we're following throughout this movie. Where we see Ford as he's kind of already within this gang. And he's really, really trying to prove himself and try to say to Sam Shepard, you know, like, I just consider myself a rung down and I really think I can show you I can get the job done if you just let me and stuff like that. And he just really wants to be accepted. But, I don't know. Because, that's a great... What makes Casey Affleck's performance so great is there's so much going on with Bob that a lot of the time, it's kind of really hard to gauge. Obviously, we know what's going to become of him by the title. Obviously, the title's one big fat spoiler. Obviously. So the question is how we get to that point. And how we get to that point is the fact that Bob was basically the very first recorded evidence of a celebrity stalker. That's basically what he is. Where he really, really tried to kind of, you know, he really wanted to be Jesse's sidekick. So he just kind of would try to throw himself in there, whether he humiliates himself or not. But he's the guy where all the gang is sitting around, and then Bob comes over and sits down, and they all get up and walk away. But it's not necessarily that they're being dicks to him. I mean, they don't really particularly care for him. But he's just somebody they just don't see. Because he's just that meaningless to them. Like, when he comes and sits down next to them, they just get up and leave because they don't even see. It's like they don't even know he's there. That's just the kind of, he just kind of blends in, and that's kind of adds to why he's so kind of, I mean, not only is he just obsessive and weird, but he just desperately wants to get himself out there and be as famous as Jesse James and, like, be alongside him and other things that we'll get into. But the thing about it is, there's just something so, like, you want to feel bad for him, because he's just so walked all over, despite how badly he just wants to be, it seems he just wants to be accepted by them, especially Jesse. But there's just something so discomforting and pathetic about him that kind of makes him almost unlikable. And it's actually, Sam Shepard is one of the first people to see it immediately. He's Jesse's brother, I think. And he, like I said, he's in one of the first scenes, Bob's talking to him and saying, you know, I feel like I can just really prove myself if you just let me, and I can, you know, say I could be one of the James boys too. And Sam Shepard's response to him is, I don't know who you are, but the more you talk to me, the more you're creeping me out. So I think his exact words are, you give me the willies.
That's great.
So he's the first one to know. Like, that's kind of the, where we end up, Sam Shepard's character was kind of already seeing flashes of it in that moment. But then we go on, and eventually he does find his way kind of into the gang, but not before, the most famous scene in this movie, probably, which is incredible, and really, really shows all the aspects of this movie coming together to perform one perfect moment, and that is the work of art that is the train robbery scene, where it's a combination of the cinematography and the score and the build-up and just all of that. Where the scene is pitch black, and then we just kind of see the light of the train coming as if it's coming around the corner, and then the train, and then Jesse's silhouette in front of it. That whole, like, even if you haven't seen the movie, surely you know that shot. You've seen it somewhere. And that's just, like I said, that scene is just a fucking work of art. There's no other way to put it. And since we're going to talk about this train robbery scene, I would like to go ahead. Obviously, Casey Affleck got a lot of attention for this movie, up to and including that Oscar nomination. But Brad Pitt blows me the fuck away in this movie. No pun intended. because, obviously, with the character being, like, the end-all, be-all character, the character that everybody in this movie wants to be, either wants to be or wants to be a part of, Like there's that scene even when he can feel Bob watching him, and obviously he's already figuring out that obsessive nature that he has. So Jesse's response to him is, "Do you want to be like me or do you want to be me?" And he just gives everybody really bad vibes. Having said all that, Brad Pitt is fucking terrifying in this movie. There's this extremely intimidating quality about him throughout the whole thing. And there's during the train robbery, for instance, there's the moment when he pulls the gun and he tells the guy to open the safe. And obviously he's got the hat and he's got the bandana around his face, so all we can see are his eyes. But just that look in his eyes is enough to scare you into doing pretty much anything. And then there's just so many, like, pretty much every time he's on screen, a tense scene is playing out. There's the scene with Garrett Dillon telling him about, like, Cummins and all that, and how he's, like, coming. So, and then there's just a real, real tension between them where he knows that something is off about Dillon and what's happening here. But the scene just kind of plays out with nothing really happening, but we know that Jesse is always ahead of the game and knows exactly what's going on. And it's just a matter of when he's going to act on getting people out of the way that need to be in order for him to do his thing. There's the scene where he's talking to Bob and just nonchalantly cuts the heads off of snakes and then wraps them around his arm. And like I said, it's just constantly discomforting because no matter how much they're trying to hide something from him or they're trying to just not do anything to maybe, just tip him off or something, you can just tell that he knows everything. Like, you can feel like you're keeping something from him, but you're probably not. And he knows, and it's just a matter of time before he does something about it. but then, to combat that, there are scenes where, like, he's playing with his family. His wife is Mary Louise Parker, and they've got two children, and they're always happy together. And then there's the scene, the very interesting scene, that really, really adds a whole other layer to his character we hadn't seen yet at this point, when he violently interrogates a child in a barn. And he's, like, beating the holy shit out of him. And the kid finally gets let up and, like, basically calls him a bastard and says he's... To put it bluntly, just basically calls him out for the piece of shit that he is. And then the kid runs away. And Jesse, as we've seen him throughout the entire movie, suddenly breaks down and cries before he gets on his horse after the scene, before they leave. And it just really adds a whole other thing to his character. But then there's the moments where he totally comes back. When he's basically just fucking with the four brothers. Charlie, Bob's brother, is Sam Rockwell, who I'll talk about more in a second. But this pit scene, when he's basically doing a hypothetical scenario, but this hypothetical scenario involves him putting a knife to Bob's throat and actually acting like he's going to slice his throat. And then once he's basically scared him into thinking he's actually about to die, he pulls away and then just starts laughing hysterically. It sounds exactly... the last scene of California, right before David Duchovny kills him, when he's doing that really, really creepy laugh.
Yeah.
He brings that laugh into this movie.
Wow.
In that scene. he almost turns right back into Early Grace in this scene. and it's really, really fucking creepy. then there's a whole other plot introduced into this movie. It's like a plot within a plot, where it comes time to... Jesse is so intimidating and will act on things that need to be fixed if they have to. A huge mistake plays out, and that is when they go to Wood, who is Jesse's cousin, who is Jeremy Renner, goes out with Dick Little to Wood's family. And Dick Little ends up sleeping with Wood's stepmother, which is a no-no. So Dick comes back, and then once Wood finds out what happens, ends up coming back for him, there is a confrontation with the two Ford brothers and the two of them, which ultimately leads to Bob setting the situation down by shooting Wood in the back of the head. Which, of course, is a very interesting foreshadowing. Because he kills Wood pretty much exactly the same way he kills Jesse. Just that very abrupt bullet to the back of the head when you're least expecting it. So, naturally, they have killed Jesse's cousin. A very beloved cousin. And they throw his naked body out into the woods and bury it with snow. And hope that nobody finds him. And Jesse doesn't find out. And so there's this ongoing dread throughout the entire rest of the movie that Jesse is going to find out. Because there's the moment where Sam Rockwell got shot in the leg during this scuffle, and Jesse asks him what happened, and they had not thought up a lie yet to tell him, so they have to, on the fly, while Jesse is staring them down suspiciously. And even though they come up with the story of him falling off the roof, we know that Jesse knows. He doesn't know that they killed Wood, but Jesse knows they're lying about the story they came up with. And that is basically fuel for a number of really suspenseful scenes. And then there is the stuff, Sam Rockwell is really, really heartbreaking in this movie. Like, the character of Charlie is just really, just a really sad thing to witness throughout this movie. Having to watch him basically be Bob's brother, but also be part of the gang, and kind of have to be on both sides, and then ultimately there's, after Wood's death, he just kind of, I guess, like, guilt is eating him away, and then he gets, like, he eventually ends up with tuberculosis, and ultimately ends up committing suicide. It's a really sad character to watch his journey go on. And he's there for the assassination of Jesse, too, so he's kind of got a, being Bob's brother, he basically kind of feels like he has no choice but to basically be a part of this. And I know it's no surprise to say this about Sam Rockwell, but God, he's really good in this.
Yeah.
I said, I know that surprises nobody, but
exactly.
Sam Rockwell's really good in this, believe it or not. So, yeah. Now, one of the big questions, really, is what exactly is going on between the... What exactly is the relationship between Jesse and Bob? With the whole... There's the whole thing. Obviously, Jesse is who Jesse is. The question is, should there be gay undertones? They're coming strictly from Bob's point of view. And that theory apparently is very, very popular within it. Because his obsession is just really, really kind of like almost to an out of control extent. Obviously to the point that he fucking killed him. He's basically like the original Mark David Chapman. That's basically what he is. Because he has all the books under his bed in a box of all the tall tales of the James brothers and stuff like that, and he's basically idolized him since the James brothers have been a gang. And it's just a matter of, you know, is it a love? Is it a hatred? Is it just kind of one turning into the other, like we've seen happen with present-day celebrities? It's just really, really difficult to get into the minds of people like that. Yeah. And Casey Affleck really went there. To where we really, really don't know exactly what makes his mind work, but we know it's really, really unsettling, and it could be a number of different things. And I guess it's really just an interpretation thing. I forgot to mention this. It's worth noting that the main composer was Nick Cave, which is great. And also, he's at the end, towards the end, shock surprise, playing a song. I always thought that was a nice cameo. And while we're on that scene, I want to talk about real quick before we end here. Yeah, the fact that when Jesse dies, there's still like a half hour of this movie left. Where it's Bob really, really, really trying to cash in on his fame of being the guy that killed Jesse James. To the point that he and Charlie plays Jesse, and they go on stage and they reenact it for people. But then the ultimate kind of closure to it where... Bob always wanted to be notorious like Jesse, and after he had killed Jesse, Jesse became famous, even more famous in death. Like, they took pictures of his dead body, and people bought it for lots of money, and they kept his body on ice so people could see it like an attraction. And Bob was basically trying to get to that same level of notoriety by constantly saying to everybody who would contact him, in contact with him, I'm the guy that shot Jesse James, love me, or something. But ultimately, that half hour, like, I imagine a lot of people probably think that half hour, it kind of loses its way and really drags on. But I think that last half hour really adds a whole other layer to it. Because obviously, the very ending is the fact that Bob himself gets killed, and then nobody gives a shit about him. Everybody remembers Jesse James, and everybody went to see his body. When Bob was dead and was forgotten. And it's only basically movies like this that we even know somebody like him existed. So that just kind of puts a whole other thing on it, I think. So, yes. I think I've got to ultimately go with Butch Cassidy, just because it's really a classic masterpiece, but The Assassination of Jesse James really got its, like, it just kind of came and went despite those two Oscar nominations. Mm. But then it kind of got, I guess you could say kind of a cult following. That's probably kind of a strong word, but it's one of those movies where if you find a certain group of people, you will find people that absolutely praise it as one of the great masterpieces we've had in quite some time. So there's a number of those people out there. But I think for the most part, like, kind of in more of a mainstream thought process, not many people really know too much about it. They just know the title is really long. That's about the extent of it. But yeah, it's definitely great and definitely worth looking at as a real epic. But just kind of with all the pieces coming together, I think I prefer Butch Cassidy, but it's, yeah.
All right.
That's just me.
And with that, we finally end January.
Yeah.
February will bring a brand new set of verses, and of course, the Academy Awards at the end of the month, so we got a big month ahead of us here on Pop when it comes to movie coverage. Next week, Cryptic Comet is Anti-Hero. So yeah, we didn't want to do this one for a while, and it's finally fell into place, so... That being said, obviously it is Sunday, which means we already had the Screen Actors Guild Awards, and we don't know the answers because we're filming this on Friday. So, Monday, Gaming with Ash returns, and the Raw Popcast, 11:30 p.m. Wednesday is the Wednesday Popcast that we're going to be at 9:30 p.m. Thursday, Brand New Sip and Snack, and Friday, AJ's Movie Reviews, Hail Caesar, Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, and The Joys. So that being said, I want to thank you guys and girls out there for watching. AJ, any parting words?
That's it.